Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I have received apologies this morning from Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for this meeting. Our first item of business is the decision to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is the first evidence session of an inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. Industry is the second highest carbon emitting sector in Scotland after transport. There is currently a target for 2045 for Scotland to cut greenhouse gas emissions to net zero. The committee is interested in looking at how we can support, incentivise and de-risk this transition, firstly in the Grangemouth area, to benefit companies and individuals. I'd like to thank everyone who responded to our call for evidence, which closed last week, and all submissions will be considered during the course of the inquiry. Today's session will focus on the challenges facing businesses. I now welcome Hisashi Kubuyama from the Federation of Small Business Scotland. He is the Development Manager for the West, who's joined by Liz McAreevy, Chief Executive of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, and we're joined by Stuart Wallace, Chief Operating Officer, and Michelle Primrose, Group HR Manager, both from Forth Ports Limited. And as always, if members and witnesses could keep their answers and questions as concise as possible, that would be helpful. So welcome to the committee this morning. If I maybe come to Hisashimi first, followed by Liz, I'll focus the questions on both of you at the start. So the government is currently producing a just transition plan for the Grangemouth area, and we expect to see the draft form of that in spring. In terms of the businesses you represent, what are you looking for in the draft report? Are you confident that the draft report will reflect the challenges that are being faced by businesses? What's your understanding of where the focus is? If I come to you first.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much, Convener. I think the it's very important to recognise that the Scotland Just Transition to Net Zero cannot be achieved without getting small businesses involved. So any plan needs to be done with thorough consultation with small business community, because they obviously operate very differently from larger businesses. And I think I mentioned it cannot be achieved without involving small businesses. It's because I think British Business Bank research suggests that around 50% of industry carbon emission is done by their small business. And it's a question, if you think about the size of a small business, which makes up about 98-90% of the entire business community, it's quite significantly smaller than that, but still it's a quite significant chunk of the emission. So it's very important to get a small business involved rather than leave them behind. And it's important for us to see them as part of a solution rather than they are the problem. So I think the in terms of things we are looking for from the government is there are barriers for small businesses to achieve net zero. They are increasingly aware of the importance of reducing carbon emission, and they've done quite a lot of things already. For example, improving the energy efficiency or reducing waste or changing the transport habits. But it's not really done in a systematic manner, if that makes sense. It can be quite piecemeal. And also, those businesses who've done some of those works did so because it makes financial sense. It's not really because of the wider net zero plan or strategy. So I think there's a bit of a confusion around what net zero makes, what net zero means as well. It can get quite jargony, things like carbon neutral. What's the difference between carbon neutral, net zero, and zero carbon as well? So quite a lot of members say to us, what does it mean for us? And where do we start in the first place? Obviously, assessing the carbon emission is a starting point, but that costs quite a lot of money. I think between £3,000 to £6,000 to ask a consultant to do it, and it takes up to 12 months or so.
And I suppose, can I ask, because the government are focusing on Grangemouth first, which is, in terms of industry, one of the highest emitting areas in Scotland. So what you've informed us, and that's kind of general idea of what all businesses across Scotland, because they're all trying to meet this target, but there's a particular focus on Grangemouth. Is there you know, what will be the impact in that area for smaller businesses? Is there, and do you feel that you've been involved enough at this stage in terms of the plan?
So
together?
I think Grange Moss makes up of, obviously, has a lot of different businesses from different sectors, but there are a lot of those in the supply chain of petrochemical industry. And those who do a lot of work for the likes of Ineos, for example, and you know the transport haulage, and the construction decommission. So it's a quite wide ranging sector. But the there's a lot of businesses do use big lorries and vans, which can they release quite a lot of gas emissions. So I think it's really the engagement with the local small business community is quite key, and if identifying the needs and you know the needs for change, and then implement some kind of support. We haven't had any significant involvement engagement with the, for example, Grange Moss Future Industry Board. I think Scottish Enterprise might be represented, but I cannot see any small business representative. But I understand that they are implementing some kind of engagement, wider engagement work. I think this year, in the first half of this year, so we are looking to engage with them more deeply, and then try. Give them feedback from our members' perspective as much as possible.
Okay, thank you. And Liz, if I come to you with a similar question about what you would hope to see in the draft plan, is the Chamber in a position at this stage to have an idea of what needs to be included in the draft plan, what kind of support businesses need, and what particular is there support that's particular to the type of businesses that are based in Grange Moss?
We're actually doing quite a lot of work around just economic transition. I sit on the city's Infrastructure Investment Programme Board, and a subgroup of that is just economic transition, and I chair the Just Economic Transition Group for Edinburgh. So we're capturing a lot of information at the moment about what that means and how businesses, particularly the SMEs, engage in the process. So I think we can inform quite a lot of that knowledge and insights to government. The Just Economic Transition Group for Edinburgh, I think, could be an interesting model that we would then engage with Grange Moss. We do an awful lot of work already with Forth Ports, obviously part of the Green Free Port, and the wider Firth of Forth, which I think really we need to look at it as the whole. But we have four subgroups from the Just Economic Transition Group, which is about just. What is just and how do we ensure that the transition to net zero is just. We've got a subgroup that looks at SME supply chain and skills, because this is about enabling SMEs to access contracts, procurement frameworks, and be part of supply chains, in which case they need to develop their own green credentials to be part of those frameworks. And we need to look at the skills. How do we ensure that SMEs can invest in the skills they need so that they can take advantage of the opportunities, clear opportunities coming through the Green Free Port and the transition of the Firth of Forth. But we've got to make sure that everybody has access to those opportunities. We're also looking at enablers, partners and finance. So government is obviously an enabler. Working with partners enables that transition to be fair and just. And the biggest barrier at the moment for SMEs is cost and finance. So we're looking at how do we support SMEs get on the journey. And then the other piece is about measurement, impact and communication, because there's a huge amount of work going on and we need to communicate to the wider, not just to the SME community, but communities. We're very interested in community wealth building, and we're very interested in how the area around the Firth of Forth is going to produce massive economic benefit for, you know, south of Scotland or southeast of Scotland and Scotland. But how do we maximise that potential by making sure that all the SMEs, 99% of businesses in Scotland are SMEs. So how do we maximise their engagement, their growth, their access to contracts, and that they have support to upskill and make sure that they're not left behind. But also, if we can use local tradespeople and local businesses and help them scale, they're creating jobs locally, and that really empowers local communities to start that local community wealth building. So I think working in partnership with corporates, harnessing the knowledge that they already have. You know, they're doing great things. They're well ahead of the game in terms of addressing their own net zero footprint. So we're looking to develop a mentoring programme so that there's knowledge sharing, and then clearly engage more widely with communication strategy. So I think we could inform a lot of the knowledge that we will pick up through the Just Economic Transition Group. So we hope that we'll have an opportunity to contribute and consult whilst you're developing the policy.
So at the moment, that work that's been undertaken, that's not linked specifically to Grangemouth, is it? That's a broad... Did you explain that?
It is broader, but I do see that it's...
But have you been engaged, in terms of the government putting together the Just Transition Forum, sorry, Just Transition Plan, which is meant to be published in the spring, have you had engagement in the drafting of that? Has there been conversations around that? Okay, thank you. Just before I bring in Michelle Thompson, if Michelle or Stuart, welcome to the committee this morning. I suppose just a general question. Do you think there's a shared understanding of what a just transition is? Because there's a number of terms. I think Hisashi talked about confusion for small businesses. Is it carbon neutral? Is it net zero? Is it what we're aiming towards here? What is the? Do you think there's a shared understanding within the Grangemouth area of what a just transition means? And what your responsibility is to help deliver that?
I think it's an evolving situation at the moment in terms of the wider community understanding what just transition means. So in the wider sense of when you've had that petrochemicals industrial complex in the area for so long, and as we head towards the transition to net zero, there are genuine proper questions being asked about what does that mean for the local community? And therefore the local residents very keen to understand for them, as we see this transition happen, that it happens in such a way that the local community benefits from that. And that was very much at the core of some of the assumptions, for example, in the Firth of Forth Green Freeport bid, in terms of looking at place-based investment going forward, in terms of what are the economic benefits that come out of the activity that's generated from inward investment, and how can that be actually seen to benefit the local communities. So looking at things like skills funds, looking at, as was talked about earlier on, how the SMEs have to interact with the Green Freeport as it develops, and some of the concepts that were in the Freeport bid around specific areas for SMEs to be the inward investors, the onus now has to be on how do we get those SME investments to happen, how do we recognise local employment, and a big part of the bid will be about that engagement piece that we want to have with the local communities around that just transition. And that's not just Grangemouth, that's also in areas like Mid Fife and areas of North Edinburgh as well. But there's a process that we'll have to go through as part of the bid development and implementation to make sure that those communities are brought along with it and fully understand the concept and delivery of a just transition.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you. I'll now come to Michelle Thompson to be followed by Graham MacDonald.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for attending. I mean, we've already alighted on a theme, I suppose, from the inside looking out, particularly with reference to Grangemouth Town, if you like. The people who live there often refer to the economy as a Dido economy, drive in, drive out. That's the sentiment and the feeling. So you've already touched, Stuart, on some of the active consideration you gave to your bid. And I'd like to just put some meat on the bones of that, thinking about Grangemouth as a community. When, in your thinking, will they start to see some of the activity that has meaning to them? And I suppose it also links in with what you were saying, Liz, about frameworks for SMEs, because I mean there's a considerable amount of work to change what is a good thrusting sentiment about that involvement into actual meaningful engagement. So I'd appreciate some meat in the bones for that.
I'd almost say it's kind of three phases, Michelle, in terms of how that comes through. So the first bit is having just been awarded the successful bid a few weeks back. We're now moving into the implementation phase, and we've got meetings next week with the Scottish Government and UK Government about how we move on to the next stage of the business planning process. And we've already identified that one of the work streams that is in that will be about communication and engagement. So a big part of this in terms of engaging with local elected members or local community councils in terms of what do we envisage happening as a result of the Green Freeport being a success. So that engagement process will start fairly soon. The second bit of it is that we need to then work through the business cases and over the next few years secure that inward investment that we want to see happening. So where we've identified, for example, specifically in Grangeford, we want to develop the freight and logistics hub, or we want to see that transition away, or to create the opportunity for alternative fuels. So the biofuel centre or the development of hydrogen in the local area is an important aspect as to how we see that being delivered. And the final part of that journey then is, if we are successful at delivering those aspirations around the Green Freeport, then what it drives is that additional non-domestic rates income, which under the policy allows the local councils, be it Falkirk, Fife or Edinburgh, to retain that additional income, and then for the local authority elected members to be working with their communities to say how is that additional income and benefit that's been generated from the Freeport then going to be spent and deliver benefit for the local community. And we have openly talked with our partners about the sense of creating a sense of place around the areas at which that we're talking about. So if that is Grangemouth, yes, Grangemouth Town Centre, how do we work with the local residents? What is it they're looking for? How do they want to benefit out of that economic activity that comes from the Freeport? But equally, the same applies in areas like north of Edinburgh or in Mid-Fife in terms of those conversations taking place. And we've talked openly, for example, about like 20-minute communities. How do you see that benefit coming through to actually make sure that the locals see the benefit of it and don't continue to have this drive-in, drive-out view of the local economic activity that takes place?
You've given me a lot of information. I know other members want to come in. In a sense, you want to come in as well, Liz, and perhaps yourself, Hisashi. But I suppose thinking about the very, very important chemical cluster and the SMEs around there, how we make it real, because part of the problem we've got is that they're there, and but it might be difficult for them to get kind of oven ready, if you like, in terms of being able to go on to procurement frameworks. So that kind of linkage of working at both ends of the conundrum, if you want, you may want to pick up on some of the earlier themes, but I'm also interested in exploring that. Perhaps you first, Liz.
Yeah, I would agree that SMEs are kind of really behind the curve on this. I think less than 21% have set themselves any targets for net zero. I think there are significant barriers to them understanding what they need to do. We did a survey about a year ago. We surveyed our SME members and our corporate members. Everybody agreed with the net zero targets, but they said that the cost, the resource, lack of understanding. There's lots of information out there. You can Google it to your heart's content, but it's not specific to their business, and it's really hard to know how they make sense of it all. Mm-hmm. Very often, you know, it's led by the founder or the business owner who's doing off the side of their desk. They don't have the resource and the time and the knowledge. And I think 60-odd% said they could not, would not pay for the support they need. We've been very lucky as a chamber, Edinburgh Chamber of Commerce. We've received shared prosperity funding. So we put a proposal into the City Council, and we've got funding to run a two-year programme which takes SMEs on a five-point journey to, mm-hmm. to net zero, which looks at kind of measuring, developing their strategies and delivering net zero. And then that in turn opens them up to supply chains, because obviously businesses are thinking of their scope 3 emissions now and how they start mm-hmm. addressing their supply chains and sort of upstream, downstream. So I think if we can get SMEs really understanding what they need to do, I mean, it's a two-year funding programme. It can't stop there, you know, and there's only so many cohorts that we can take on it. But we're also, as part of that, we're delivering outreach community sessions to get communities owning their own net zero journey as well. So I agree with Stuart. This is about engagement. This is about communications and sort of sharing the knowledge. But it has to be done in partnership. I think everybody has to get involved in this. Mm-hmm. So I don't think one section can solve this problem. But I think SMEs have got a huge role to play in this, and it's particularly in terms of maximising the economic potential that this transition will deliver for Scotland.
Mm-hmm. And if I can just ask of you, again, starting with yourself, Stuart, about young people in particular and targeting that. I mean, I appreciate the bid that you've come up with is at very early stages, but again, I'm interested in knowing more about how you're going to be able to drive down, or if indeed you intend to do that, to actively target young people in terms of job creation, which is another issue that Grangemouth as a centre struggles with.
Yeah, I mean, at the core of the bid, there is the aspiration to create 20,000 jobs linked to the activity that we do at Grangemouth. Now, those 20,000 jobs are not just directly in Grangemouth, they're the whole supply chain. But we do recognise from having looked at the bid about where we've got areas of deprivation, where we've got high unemployment, where we've got high numbers of children that are remaining NEET, and therefore these are things that we have to address. As part of the bid, we've identified that we want to work and have already started working very closely with Forth Valley College, Edinburgh College, Fife College. We've been talking to Edinburgh University, Strathclyde, etc., in terms of the academic aspect of that. But more importantly, I think the emphasis on the people that are participating, for example, in the Green Freeport bid seem to be engaging with young people through education. So taking people from our own business, volunteers, putting them into schools, talking about STEM, talking about the industries that we're involved with. There's Fuel Challenge, which is a local initiative that we've been involved with as well. And to really energise and enthuse that younger generation, first of all, on the transition to net zero and the just transition to net zero, but also to get them engaged in the local industry that's there, to make them excited about the opportunities that exist on their doorstep. And the bid did make a commitment to say that, in conjunction with working with further and higher education and the schools, that the economic activity should drive the possibility to create a £2 million plus skills fund. So we would be looking at how that skills fund could be used, for example, to create, for example, bursaries, where we could take applications for perhaps families or children who have not normally looked to go into further education or to gain further qualifications, and to use that funding to get people involved in the local industry with the right skill set that they're trying to achieve to get into those positions.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of questions I know my colleagues want to come in on. So just a last one. Do you all feel that at this point where we are, it's obviously very early days, that that you've got the right people contributing at this point? And is there anybody else that you think should, well, we really need to bring this organisation or this group in to make sure all these views are reflected? Have you been able to cover everything? And just a last wee question. Tell me if my assumption is correct. One of the concerns around Freeport's expressed generally is that it displaces economic activity. From my point of view, the fact that so much is centred around Grangemouth, that won't be the case because a lot of the economic activity is already there, and it's simply galvanising that, and it can only add to it. So those two questions, and then I'll hand over.
Well, I'll pick on the displacement one to start with, just in terms of governance, and I'll let some colleagues come in. So at the core of the bid is a very strong governance arrangement that has to be there. And from the experience that we've had of implementing the Freeport in England under the policy so far as well, there are rules and expectations around who is eligible to receive the fiscal benefits that are part of the Freeport policy. And those rules are very clear. It's about additionality. The policy is about new inward investment. It's about creating new jobs, new industries, new skills, etc. So the governing arrangements that will be put in place will be very strong in making sure that what we don't have is displacement. So this is not about moving one business from one area to the other to just give it some fiscal incentives. This is about new additional positions and inward investment. So we will make sure through the governing arrangements that that displacement is not an issue or a matter that comes up as a result of the implementation of the fourth Green Freeport policy.
OK. And is everyone involved at this point in time, given its early doors, who needs to be? Last question.
I think it's early days. and I think business has shown a commitment to deliver just economic transition. Certainly, we work very closely with Forth Ports. We also work with developing the young workforce. We work with EVOC, the Edinburgh Volunteers Association, lots of third sectors. So currently, I think there's lots of conversations and lots of activity. And Stuart and I have mentioned it's how we pull all that together, because there are so many different groups doing good things. But if we can combine that into a kind of a force, where we're all pulling in the same direction, I think that's the challenge for us now, is to sort of map all the activities that's going on and pull a strong partnership together so that we can drive in the right direction.
OK, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. Just to continue the conversation we're having from what Michelle started, The Grangemouth Future Industry Board has the Joint Just Transition Plan, and it says the plan will outline a shared view of what the industrial cluster would look like by 2045, and it continues, the transition can maximise socio-economic benefit for the surrounding area. So, given the target of 2045, what would you like to see in the small, medium and long term to ensure that SMEs are at the heart of this, Hisashi?
Thank you very much. I think the we'd like to see the it would be good to, for the Grangemouth Future Industry Board to have some kind of SME specific engagement plan, because the as I think this is well known that the SMEs are time poor, and the even though they are really aware of the importance of transition to net zero and then they want to do something, they often do not know where to start, who to speak to. And I think it's partly because of the a little bit confusing support landscape as well. The I understand the Scottish Enterprise has expertise on net zero. There's Zero Waste Scotland, and we've seen a recent establishment of Business Energy Scotland, and the council have Business Gateway support on the ground. And also, if you go onto the web, you know, there are a lot of UK-wide organisations. Carbon Trust is there. Mm. And also zerocarbonbusiness.uk website is there. So, and there's so much information out there, and then it can be quite confusing. Yeah. And that contributed to the fact that a lot of small businesses are quite confused about the definition of net zero, where to start and things. So I think the starting point should be quite low about raising awareness about the net zero and then engage. But I think engagement has to be on the ground, basically door-to-door basis. And that's why we need a specific SME-focused engagement plan from for if we're really serious about getting small business involved.
Okay. Liz, your view on it?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're at the start of the journey. And I agree with you, we need the short, medium, long-term plans in place. And I think awareness and supporting SMEs understand what net zero means and what they need to do. And at the moment, I don't think that there's real resource being put into that. I think communication engagement is difficult. Lots of things are happening, but communication, I mean, we've built, just in Edinburgh, we've built Net Zero Edinburgh platform, but it requires a lot of social media, a lot of engagement, a lot of communications to let businesses know where they can come for help. We're trying to set up a mentoring program because we're very aware that corporates are doing a huge amount of work in this space. They've got departments on sustainability and bright, you know, graduates. How do we share? How do we tap into that knowledge and share that free of charge? So we're trying to get businesses, corporates, through their sort of ESG program, start giving back. So I think it's early days, and we know there's a lot of work to be done. We've started, as I say, this 5-point journey for SMEs, but there's a huge number that just don't know how to get started. So I think that we've got to recognise this is not going to be fixed overnight, and that this is definitely a journey. But there are willing partners, and businesses are really putting a lot of support and resource into this.
Well, one of the issues you touched on earlier was about the lack of financial support for SMEs to engage on, you know, this journey that we're on. You know, where did you see the nature of that financial support?
Well, we've been fortunate that we've been given shared prosperity funding. So free of charge for the next 2 years, we will be running programmes to support SMEs get on the journey. I'm not suggesting that there's, you know, funds given out to SMEs. I mean, I think that we all know there's no money available. Yeah. So it's how do we tap into the existing knowledge? How do we leverage what we already have? And how do we ensure that support is given? It has to be free of charge. They can't really afford to pay for the support they need. So I think it's about partnerships and everybody taking part in that. But I do think that we need to look at the funding situation. It's going to cost billions to get this delivered, just in terms of SMEs sorting out their own energy efficiency, you know, insulation, transport issues. So, I think that we do need to look at what grant funding might be available.
Okay. Sasha, did you?
Yeah, the funding situation. I think I understand that the Folk Council has set up the specific grants for the assisting small businesses achieving net zero. I think it's on a 50-50 contribution basis. So businesses need to contribute 50% of the cost. Mm-hmm. And then that's up to, I think it was £10,000. Mm-hmm. And the if you look at the cost for small businesses to really achieve the net zero, to get things, get work done, it's really scratching the surface. I think if small businesses which maybe own 3 or 4 commercial vans, if they want to replace the fleet with the electric vans, the cost will be like £100,000 or £150,000. And I think we need to really talk about this, you know, the resources, financial resources. If you really want to assist small businesses to work on the just transition, because they cannot achieve it themselves financially. Okay.
Stuart, how can we ensure that opportunities from the transition are accessible for local businesses?
I think there's a couple of areas that are key in that, Gordon. One, I think, to touch on, for example, the Grangemouth Future Industries Board. Mm-hmm. So we're all at the start of this journey now. So we've got the Falkirk Growth Bid deal that's in place. We've got the Green Freeport. We've got GFIB, who've got their initiative going on. So how do we collectively pull all of that together? And make sure that we've got the right strategy for the local area. I think we need to start to get GFIB and local businesses talking a bit more about what does this actually mean in terms of delivery going forward. I think we need to be clear in our view as to what is the transition, so what are the technologies that we're looking to enhance and develop and implement to replace what we've got today at the petrochemicals complex, or through different transport modes, for example, in the freight hub that we've got in the Falkirk-Grangemouth area. And then what we need to be doing is then saying, OK, well, what does that then mean for supply chains? So we specifically, for example, in the Green Freeport bid, in each of the three tax sites, earmarked areas for land that would be available for SMEs. So to look at young, new, upcoming businesses, entrepreneurs, giving them the chance to come into facilities that are suitable and adequate for what they want to see in terms of developing their own businesses, get them entitled to the fiscal benefits that are there, and really attract that kind of entrepreneurial new business spirit to come in as we see some of these technologies transition over the next kind of few years. So for me, there's a big picture piece that we need to start with in terms of where are we going with this petrochemicals complex, where are we going with the transport hub that we've got at the moment. How do we then start to distill that down into what does it mean for supply chains, for skills, and then would the incentive packages that we've got, like the growth bid or like the Freeport, actually be communicating, marketing, looking at the right inward investment opportunities, tying in with organisations like Scottish Enterprise, SDI, etc., to make sure that we get the right attractiveness for those businesses coming into the Grangemouth area.
This land that you're talking about that's been put aside, would this allow existing businesses to grow, or is this about encouraging innovation?
No, it's both. I think if you've got existing businesses in the area that want to grow, that are bringing additionality but are perhaps in not the right type of facilities at the moment, and looking to grow, that are maybe looking for a 10,000 or a 20,000 square feet facility rather than a 10-acre site or 100,000 square feet shed, then we've looked across each of the tax sites in the bid and said, where could we earmark bits of land where smaller type developments that could be developed that are more suitable for these areas? We know through the growth bid deal in Falkirk, and then in conjunction with the Green Freeport, for example, there's the concept of an innovation hub inside the Grangemouth tax site. And certainly in the Forth Ports land, in areas of the port that are no longer used for port activity, we've identified brownfield sites where we could develop sort of smaller industrial unit type facilities to attract that kind of inward investment. So it's about local businesses being able to grow. There's an example here in Edinburgh of one business that we know that are actively involved in renewables that are very constrained. They can't manufacture any more than what they're doing at the moment because they're in an industrial unit that doesn't allow them to upsize. But we've had discussions with them as part of the bid that says, well, could you enhance or grow into a different type of facility in, for example, the Port of Leith? So those conversations have already started about existing businesses growing, adding more people, adding more output, as well as inward investment opportunities.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. There's a couple of areas I would like to explore a little bit. Over a number of years, I've heard so many projections as to the number of jobs that might be created as a result of renewables, just transition and so forth. Now, Forth Ports have projected that the economic modelling projects up to 20,000 new jobs for the area. Now, what are the assumptions around that? And importantly, are these gross or net figures? In other words, you know, the anticipation is that there will be a reduction in jobs, most likely in the fossil fuel sector, in favour of renewables. So is that a net figure? And I guess, Stuart, you're the man to ask.
Yeah, I mean, when you're going through a bid process for a policy like the Green Freeport, then you follow the government-recognised modelling techniques that are done. So we effectively start up with a master plan of effectively the 550 hectares of land that are in the Green Freeport across all three tax sites. We looked at how you would develop that site, and then there is economic data that says that over time, as those sites are developed, these are the numbers of jobs that these sectors and those industries tend to develop. So if it's logistics, or it's petrochemicals, or it's renewable manufacturing, or it's advanced manufacturing, shipbuilding, for example, across all the locations, all of that is fed into the model. The 20,000 jobs that are specific around the Grangeworth area, or the Grangeworth tax site, are about the wider impact of the activity that takes place there. So if you've got that activity happening in the area of the Grangeworth tax site, then the knock-on effect of all of that should be that 20,000 jobs. And we know that ourselves and Forth Ports, that usually for every one job that there is in the port itself, there's about another 8 jobs that are created in the wider supply chain. And we know that INEOS talk about there's 2,000 direct employees on site, but if you look at the wider supply chains that happens, it's probably about 17,000 to 20,000 jobs that are associated with the wider supply chains. So they are all kind of jobs that are knock-on results of the inward investment. The job number that is quoted is a gross jobs number that's there, but the aspiration of the policy is that it's additional. It's about attracting new inward investment and therefore new jobs. So we would hope and aspire to delivering that over the longer duration of the benefit of the Freeport policy to see those as the top jobs that are provided and not to have that loss in other areas.
Well, there's a couple of points come out of that. Firstly, you're saying it's a gross figure. Do we have any projections as to on the other side of the coin, what jobs are going to be no longer required, that are not needed, that will go away?
We don't have that kind of modelling, but I certainly know through the conversations that we've had with the partners in the bid, that's not the aspiration. The aspiration is to achieve a just transition. So those jobs that are in certain sectors at the moment that may well decline, how do you introduce the new technologies? How do you introduce the new fuels, the new energy sources of the future that will prevent that happening? So there'll be an element of transition, and the Scottish Government's own document that came out in terms of the plan and even the hydrogen strategy is about how many new jobs get created from these evolving industries. So there will be a change, there will be a transition, but overall the modelling at the moment says that we're aiming for those to be additional new jobs in total.
And a clarification on your opening statement there. These jobs are not just simply about renewables and the actual change to new technologies. There are also expansions and changes in existing sectors. Would that be correct?
Correct, yeah.
So we don't have actually a figure for the new jobs that hopefully are going to be created, as a result, direct result of the transition to net zero.
No, let me be clear that the bid document that was submitted through the modelling that was done on the landmass that we have and the sectors that we focused in on has indicated that it should create 20,000 new jobs linked to the activity that happens in Grangemouth. Those should be new jobs created as a result of the Green Freeport coming through. The position in terms of whether it is from existing, there will be elements of growth of existing businesses. So if you take something like the logistics and the freight, that's already happened, but we want to see that grow. Grangeworth is already Scotland's freight hub. The Port of Grangeworth is already Scotland's largest container terminal. We want to see that volume grow. And we've been working in conjunction with Scottish Government by stuff that's been led, for example, by Ivan McKee, where we've been looking at freight flows, freight leakage out of Scotland. How do we actually get some of that freight to be going back in and out of our own ports, using our own rail connectivity, etc. So part of that 20,000 will come from existing industry that will go and develop. Part of the 20,000 will come from the new industries that will be created, or the new technologies that will be introduced as part of the just transition.
Okay. Liz, do you have a comment on this?
It was interesting. I mean, if you look at Skills Development Scotland, you know, they've produced a sort of their green skills report. You know, they are suggesting that about 9.9% of the existing 2.5 million jobs that we have in Scotland will be due to increased demand because of the green economy. We're looking at 4.3% for emerging jobs. So I think it's a very interesting landscape. It's really hard to kind of be definitive of what it's going to be. But what we're certain of, there's going to be new technology, new innovation, but there are also going to be jobs around waste management, engineering, professional occupations, trades that all need to upskill to be part of the green economy. And I think there's also a difference between green jobs and green economy jobs. I think every job is going to have to be a green job at some point. So, and what's really interesting is the research shows, SDS show, that the higher skilled jobs are higher paid. So what we're looking at is, instead of an average salary of about 23,000, we're looking at 29,000 because of that enhanced skill that these new jobs will bring, and the new businesses and industries will create.
I mean, it sounds very good, creating all these new jobs. Where are the people coming from?
That's a great question to ask. I mean, that's one of the biggest issues right now, is labour shortage. I mean, most of the businesses we're dealing with are working under capacity, so that clearly is having an impact on productivity. So that is a huge challenge. So you're absolutely right. How do we attract talent to Scotland? How do we upskill? We've also got to look at mature workers coming back into the workforce. We've got to look at encouraging those far from the workforce being brought into the workforce. And this is where we talk about sort of community wealth building. If we can have communities use local tradespeople and local businesses, and they have access to these larger contracts, they can scale and grow and create jobs. And we want to work with them to say, how do we offer flexible working so that those people who have care responsibilities or far from the workforce, how do we bring them back in and allow them through flexible working and other resources to be able to start to work? So I think there's a lot of things that we can do to increase the workforce.
There seems to be a great optimism that projecting all these jobs, that we'll be able to fill them from someplace. And at the moment, isn't that a bit doubtful?
I think we have to be optimistic, but at the same time, it's going to be a huge challenge. I mean, I don't underestimate the challenge. That, as I say, the biggest challenge at the moment, apart from kind of inflation, cost of doing business, is labour shortage for businesses.
Sasha, do you have a comment on this?
Not necessarily, but I think as Liz mentioned, the recruitment is a very, very significant issue. I think we talk about businesses not really sure whether they could find suitable the people to employ in the next few months. So if we talk about 5-year plan, 10-year plan, and it's, there's a lot of work needs to be done, and where do people come from? That's a really important question, because for those people to come, we need to make sure that the public good public transport links are in place, and often businesses do find it difficult to employ people who do not have the measure of transport to basically go back to. Go to work and back home if they don't own a car. So I think there's need to be some serious work to be done on this, the jobs to be created. That would be good, but where do people come from, and then making sure that the transport links are in place.
Michelle,
you want to?
You're a bit of an expert on employment. Where are they going to come from?
I mean, I think that's a particularly challenging question, given both the UK challenges and global challenges on resourcing. You know, personally, we have found resourcing challenging over the last 2 years, but we are not under-resourced in any of the ports in Scotland and not in Grangemouth. And the majority of our employees have 15 years plus service in Scotland. So we are a real sustainable employer once you're in our employment, and we offer real good, strong skills and growth in those areas. But as Liz and has already referred to, we need to be able to attract employees into Scotland, into these new jobs as well, and be able to offer the training and the skills. So again, the collaboration and partnership is essential to be able to do that, because we won't be able to do that on our own.
Let me just move on from that. Scottish Government strategies have highlighted the potential economic opportunities from carbon capture, utilisation and storage, and hydrogen. What are the key risks around those technologies, and what would the enablers be that need to be put in place to ensure their success? Stuart, I'll start with yourself.
Well, I'll start by saying I'm not a chemical engineer, so therefore I'm not probably the best person to answer specific questions around risk of a particular product. However, what I would say is that, for example, in the Grangemouth area, there are now decades of experience, knowledge and understanding of the petrochemicals process and how you manufacture, example, products like hydrogen. So we're not starting from scratch in terms of doing that. I think there's a huge amount of work that's already been done around carbon capture, utilisation and storage. So it's not just about capturing and storing, but then ultimately how can you use the carbon that's captured as well? And from a policy point of view, then certainly, for example, being able to see the Acorn project in conjunction with the UK government moved off the reserve list and moved into the agreed funding position, I think would be a huge step forward in Scotland's position of wanting to achieve net zero by 2045. I mean, INEOS, who are a huge customer of Forth Ports Group and are our neighbour at Grangemouth, are committing vast sums of money to the development of hydrogen and carbon capture technology. They've already made the commitment, for example, to be a base load of 1 million tonnes a year to a project like Acorn in terms of capturing and then feeding that carbon up the gas pipeline back up to St Fergus. And also been very proactive at looking at the wider Central Belt. So how can INEOS be a facilitator with other businesses in and around the central area of Scotland to act as an enabler for that carbon capture? So how can the benefit of the petrochemicals complex, all of that infrastructure that exists around there, all of that knowledge, then for them to work with partners, be it in energy from waste plants, be it in cement production facilities, etc., to say, how do we gather all of this together and really at pace then collect the vast amount of CO2 that's emitted in the Central Belt and transmit that up to the storage capability that we've got up in the northeast. So that in conjunction, I would say, with a very positive and inclusive view towards things, for example, like planning and consenting. So I think we need to get better at streamlining that and have a Team Scotland view to actually giving certainty to planning and consenting, so that in a controlled way that we can get to a position where there is certainty to develop this technology and bring it to reality. Those are key parts for me. So risks are around, for example, timeline, scales, hitting issues with consenting and approval. I don't see a risk from my understanding of lack of technical knowledge or lack of technical understanding to bring it to reality, because we've got that in abundance at the moment with the industries that we've got. We just need to give the mechanism by which that can now get converted and brought to reality.
What about enablers? What would help push these forward?
Well, as I say, I think, for example, to see Project Acorn come forward as approved and to see that carbon capture and storage capability, that technical work that's already been done, move to the next phase of delivery. When it comes to being able to implement new production facilities and to see that transition to whether it's biofuels, whether it's sustainable aviation fuel, whether it's hydrogen production, having certainty around the consenting and the approval process for that, I think would be a huge enabler in terms of industry working in collaboration with government and other authorities to say, how do we get to this end result?
Liz.
Sorry.
I'd just like to make some progress and let other members come in. If there's time at the end, we can come back to this line of questioning. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Colm Smith.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to all who've joined us this morning. Thank you for being here. Following on from Colin Beattie's questions, I might have different views of some of the new technologies that you've just been talking about, Stuart, and some of the risks associated with them, I suppose, particularly around the potential displacement of activity and resource for technologies that we know are carbon neutral now. And you talk about the petrochemical industries and the different facets of that. CCUS and hydrogen, obviously relying, a continued reliance on that petrochemical extraction continues a drag, I suppose, on carbon emissions. I suppose one of the questions I'm interested in is, in the Just Transition Commission report, they talked very much about the need for test sites, demonstration sites. And what is your view around the risks of what we currently have at Grangemouth and what we could potentially have around the different technologies that we haven't been either proving the concept of or trying to prove the concept of for the last 20 years? What are the different new genuinely carbon neutral technologies that you see having potential at Grangemouth?
I'm not sure that I'm completely the best person to answer that question, because that's, I think, is more for the existing petrochemicals cluster to answer. What I would say is that we as Forth Ports, and I know any other businesses in the local area, work to very strict health and safety rules and protocols around the way that processes work today, etc., and that overall wider safety management. And I would certainly not see that in our business or anybody else's business changing as you move from one technology to another. That's a change management process, Maggie, in terms of doing that. So I wouldn't see it as being done in any riskier way than what we do today. What I would say, though, is that in the Firth of Forth Green Freeport bid, it is wider than just the position of Grangemouth and the petrochemicals complex. Mm-hmm. So, yes, whilst we're talking about Grangemouth here, there's a big part of this is about, for example, the creation of Scotland's largest offshore wind marshalling and consolidation yard at the Port of Leith. So that's taking assets that for the last 50 years were used in the oil and gas sector and converting them into how do we make sure that we've got the right supply chain to deliver offshore wind at pace in Scotland. But the important bit of the bid and the important bit about the land that we have at Leith is about the aspiration, and I would say the determination we've got to introduce manufacturing with that as well. So that's a different set of skill set. Mm-hmm. That's about metal fabrication, it's about mechanical, electrical technology, it's about blade construction or towers, whatever it ends up being in terms of that local supply chain element. But we've got a strong thread all the way through the bid about that aspiration, both at Leith now, but then equally also going forward as we see genuinely carbon neutral, so using renewable sources like wind or like tidal or like wave, and saying how do we use the Green Freeport bid to really push some of that technology forward. And we're already working with some of the developers, for example, as to how we move to larger scale floating offshore wind, and we've got a strong aspiration for the Forth to be at the core of that, using the assets that we've got, for example, at Leith and Burnt Island, for example, in terms of how we can use the estuary in a different way. So the first part of your answer, I can't genuinely, because I'm not on that side of industry, but certainly as part of the bid, there's a very, very strong aspiration in there to be really focused on those renewable sectors that are not linked to petrochemicals, genuinely offshore wind, tidal, and wave. And even, I mean, the ports have got a strong history of handling components for onshore wind, and I know in the Scottish Government plan for the Just Transition, we've got aspirations to further grow what we've got as onshore wind electricity generation. So that will all factor into the capability that we've got on the Forth to help enable that.
Okay, thank you. And I accept what you say about the first part. Can I just explore a little bit more in terms of the demonstrator capabilities for the supply chain? Do you What else are you looking for? I suppose it's similar to the enabler question, but specifically for the supply chain.
Yeah, there are two parts that I would say that were in the bid that we have in Scotland, and we also had elements of this when we had the bid that we pulled together down south as well. So the first part is about innovation, and one of the core elements of the Freeport policy is about developing innovation. So we will be looking to use the fiscal benefits that are there to effectively provide a kickstart from a cash flow management point of view to allow innovation to take place. So that goes back again to whether it's at large scale, perhaps on inward investment in, for example, one of the petrochemical sites, or whether it's small scale in the SME type business arrangement that is there. The other aspect that came forward as part of the wider UK and now Scottish Government policy around the Freeport is what they call the Freeport Regulatory Engagement Network, the FREN. So we have an absolute need to make sure that we get the regulatory body. So in that, I'm talking about people like SEPA, like SNH, like Health and Safety Executive, like the local authorities, etc., together to make sure in a controlled way and a collaborative way that we can make sure that the regulatory framework actually works in favour of some of these demonstrator projects. So if we want to be moving forward with innovation, we want to be moving forward with new technology, back to the point about consenting and licensing, let's use the FREN as a mechanism to do that, whereby collectively we can get to the right result and allow those demonstration projects to kick off.
Okay, thank you, Stuart. That's interesting. Liz, if I can come to you. You spoke about the just economic transition, and you're quite clear that's how you phrase it. We've heard already this morning about the importance of shared understanding of what that means, and I suppose I'm just curious as to why you use just economic transition rather than just transition, and why is that your framing of this?
Because I think this provides a huge opportunity for economic growth, and I think if everyone can benefit from that, then we're going to have wealthier communities. We're going to have more successful businesses. To me, it's about creating the right environment in which businesses can thrive and grow the economy, because we all then benefit. We create jobs and we create wealth for Scotland. So I do see it as a mixture of kind of, as Gordon said, socio-economic. You know, I think they are very symbiotic. You can't have one without the other. So if we want a just society and a strong society and strong communities, we have to have a strong economy. And I don't think that we should shy away from the fact that we need to grow and we need businesses that are profitable and successful. And if they are, then we all benefit. But the key to this is making sure that everyone does benefit from it. And how do we share that and ensure that everybody's engaged in that process?
I suppose I'm just curious, because I think the just transition, as a phrase, my understanding, and I think many people's understanding, recognises the vital importance of social infrastructure within that, you know, health, social care, culture, all of those things. And I understand what you say about the economy underpinning that, but actually those things underpin the people who drive the economy. So we're almost trying to go deeper down. And I'm just curious to understand what you think your role, your members' roles are in ensuring that we don't just focus on the economic aspects of this, but we are actually looking, as the Just Transition Commission urges us to, looking at the social infrastructure that actually underpins society, which is much bigger than just the economy.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, businesses are very cognizant that they are place-based and very much part of the communities in which they operate. We sit on the Fair Work, you know, the Living Wage group, the Climate group. You know, we're not just about driving economic growth. We engage across the whole spectrum of business with purpose, the Fair Work agenda. So we recognise that it's our role to not only support business to be successful and to thrive, but to create the right environment in which they can operate properly and with purpose. So I do think it's not just about businesses being profitable, although there's nothing, absolutely nothing wrong with making profit, but it has to be business with purpose and the Fair Work agenda. We are working very hard with businesses to make sure that we all follow that and create strong societies as well as a strong business environment.
Okay, thanks. I know you want to make
thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Just to follow up on the points raised by Colin Maggie, one of the biggest criticisms
of the current transition to renewables is that it may have reduced emissions, but it hasn't delivered the economic benefits, particularly, for example, around onshore wind to Scottish businesses. So how do we avoid the same mistakes when it comes to offshore wind? So, Stuart, can I talk specifically about investment in ports? I mean, what level of investment in port infrastructure in Scotland is needed to ensure that it's Scottish firms that are able to benefit from the opportunities, particularly, for example, from the leasing of the ScotWind projects? And where's this investment going to come from?
Well, that investment is happening now. So we've already invested in excess of £40 million in the Port of Dundee. That was signed off and delivered a number of years back on the basis of knowing that this market was coming and wanting to make sure that we could deliver marshalling and consolidation capability in Scotland. And that does drive local content in terms of, for example, onshore logistics contracts that have to happen about moving components around. There are marine aspects that happen with these offshore winds. So we own a towage business that will also pick up benefit out of these vessels going in and out. And then the second phase of that investment for us is that we are now investing £50 million, for example, in Leith and what will be Scotland's largest offshore wind marshalling consolidation yard. So four times larger than what we've got in Dundee, or four times bigger than what exists in Scotland at the moment. And as I said earlier on, that will have land that is earmarked for manufacturing capability and SME capability. At different aspects of aspirations around ports. So we know up in Cromarty they've invested heavily on further developing their capability, either at the Port of Cromarty Firth or at NIG. So we've seen both of those organisations develop forward, and that was the other successful green Freeport bid in terms of Inverness and Cromarty. And we know that developers are looking across the east coast of Scotland, particularly at the moment, because that's where the development is happening, to look at places like Montrose, like Eyemouth, who are getting successful outcomes of this in terms of operational and maintenance bases for these facilities going forward. So I would say the port sector absolutely recognises the need to invest in infrastructure to create land, to create facilities for this market as it's coming on. And I would say as a sector, then we are stepping up to that plate. We are already making the investment and private sector investment to deliver that and to make sure that we get as much local content as we can. That is in conjunction with the ScotWind round bidding that went out, with some of the requirements that are there in terms of local content that has to happen. And therefore that ecosystem around something like offshore wind is starting now to develop and grow out as a result of these investments that the port sector is making.
So what will make sure that we absolutely get the maximum benefits from that? Like you mentioned earlier, the consenting process, obviously that steady stream of work is increasingly important, but what other role does government have and the policy makers have to make sure that investment continues? I mean, will it all come from the private sector? Is there a need for government investment there? I mean, what else do we need to do to maximise the potential of ScotWind for Scotland?
I think back to your point a second ago about that consenting process. So when you go through the bidding process of the developers securing, for example, in ScotWind and the next rounds of that will come, then how do we get certainty of that consenting process as quickly as we possibly can to make sure there's a constant pipeline of activity, so that then gives certainty to, for example, investors and manufacturing capability that knows they've got a long-term pipeline of activity to take place. From our business, we don't see the need for government intervention. We've got long-term shareholders who are predominantly pension funds who are there to look at long-term value creation to pay people's pensions over many years, and we are in this for the long term, recognising this is a sector that probably has the best part of 25, 30 plus years of an industry going forward ahead of us. So for us, for me, it's about that certainty, that consenting, that planning aspect that government needs to do to give that certainty to the industry that this is something that will get delivered in the short, medium and the long term, to give that confidence to the supply chain to then come through.
And you mentioned the Scottish Cluster, the ACON project, and the fact that it has been awarded Track 2 status. I mean, how important is that project to a just transition for the Grangemouth area, and what are your expectations of it actually receiving the ultimate, go-ahead from government? Is there any barriers here, or is it just simply a case of waiting for that go-ahead?
I'm not completely close to the ins and outs of the project. However, what I would say is that I know, in talking to some of the people that are involved in ACORN, For example, at the Ineos complex, we've already seen the emissions in that complex go from 5 million tonnes a year to 3 million tonnes a year. And they have made the commitment that should Acorn go forward, then they will underpin that tonnage that will feed into that system by another million tonnes of CO2 capture per annum. So they will go from 3 million to 2 million tonnes on site. That's a fundamental commitment by Ineos to underpin that volume activity to go through that. As I said earlier on, I do know that those conversations are now taking place with other industrial emitters in the Central Belt, bearing in mind that 40% of all of Scotland's industrial emissions come from the Central Belt. So how do we use the infrastructure that we've already got to make sure that we can capture that and transmit it? So I do see Acorn as a fundamental step in Scotland's journey to net zero. That is a huge amount of carbon to capture, to transmit and then to store. So I do see it as very important that that gets approved and signed off. But there are other aspects to that, which are conversations that are already taking place, for example, with Scottish Gas Networks. How do we make sure that we reconfigure existing infrastructure properly? And if you look at the Just Transition Plan or the Hydrogen Plan, where we've got aspirations in Scotland to be an exporter of hydrogen or an importer of CO2, that's where there is the role of, for example, the port sector, be it the trust model or the private model, to be recognising that that sector has the ability to develop and grow, and therefore you need to be either repurposing existing infrastructure that's either been used for oil and gas or for a different sector, or to create new to handle the ships that will bring in either the carbon that's been captured elsewhere or to export the green hydrogen, hopefully, at the end of the day, in terms of once we have implemented all the renewable energy generation, that we can actually use that for the production of green hydrogen and become a net exporter of hydrogen out of Scotland.
Thank you. Just before I bring Fiona Hislop in, we took evidence from the Just Transitions Commission as well as the Climate Change Committee. There have been some issues raised around private finance. The committee is interested in looking at how you de-risk this process. I don't know, Stuart, if you're able to comment on this. So a key challenge is linking the considerable quantity of private finance available with the need. It's, you know, how to get the flow through to power all the proposals that are on the table and what we can see, what we need to do in terms of reaching net zero. We've looked, the committee has an interest in the Scottish National Investment Bank as one of the kind of players in this. I suppose you want to give an overview of what, you know, is there more that needs to be done in order to support private finance coming into Scotland?
Yeah, I certainly know that there's been a lot of conversations with, for example, SNIB about their role to help some of this investment stuff go forward. I can only speak from our perspective in terms of, as I said earlier, we've got long-term shareholders. They are all pension funds from around the world as well as the UK. And they are in our business for the long term. We've just in the middle at the moment of going through refinancing some of our private placement loans that we've got that are underlying lending. And I would say in the response to that has been exceptional, recognising that Scotland has a huge opportunity in terms of the markets that are evolving and things like the renewable sector, and recognising that that investment needs to be made, but you're going to get a return over time as a result of that. So when you're out talking to lenders and potential investors, then there's a very strong and keen interest that comes through from that. And I would say back to the whole question of net zero and just transition, we know through our own shareholders and the funds that they hold, there's a very, very strong interest now in where funds have been used to invest in, and a very much a stronger, greener agenda that comes through from that. So much of this just transition, or looking at new sectors like offshore wind, the repowering of onshore wind and the infrastructure and things that's needed for that, is a very positive story to be talking to investors who have money to invest in sectors where the green agenda is much, much more important for them now. And therefore, I think we have, certainly in our business, we have a strong opportunity to raise the required funds that are needed for that future investment going forward.
Thank you. I recognise that you're here just representing Forth Ports and not kind of broader issues. But I don't know, Liz, if you want to say anything about the businesses that you represent in terms of the flow of private finance into supporting just transition. Are you finding that people are able to access? And you know, we have heard from other witnesses this morning as well as in previous sessions that there is an appetite and there's a recognition there's investment and returns to be made here. But do you find the flow of money is as positive?
I think this is, you know, the conundrum. We know there's plenty of money out there, and we've just got to make sure that we've got investable propositions to attract that money. You know, when you speak to investors, and even City Council, there's a recognition that Edinburgh particularly is one of the top five destinations for investment globally. So there's no shortage of attracting money here. But I think at the moment, the modelling, it's very, very difficult to find out how you get that return on the investment. I think there's a lot more modelling to be done. In fact, I had a meeting with Adrian Gillespie, Chief Executive of Scottish Enterprise, last week, and he's keen that we look at a net zero investment conference to be held in Scotland, but a European conference. I was very involved 13 years ago in the Low Carbon Investment Conference. I worked with Adrian then. That was at the time when it was the Crown Estate's round three offshore licensing, and how did we kind of fund this massive offshore wind potential that kind of, you know, died a bit and then now is picking up again. But, you know, we've got the same issue now for net zero. I think we need to start engaging with potential funders and what are the models that we can drive. I mean, Royal Bank of Scotland are doing a lot of work supporting SMEs, providing funds for this, but it's just the return on the investment is so long, it's really difficult to make it work right now. So I think there's work to be done, and there's certainly, you know, I think there's a building of momentum now that how do we leverage a lot of the infrastructure investment already happening to benefit some of the smaller businesses.
Thank you. Fiona has thoughts before I give some.
Good morning and thank you for joining us. I want to focus on skills particularly. You've already talked about labour shortages, so I'll leave that to one side. This is about skills development. And I'll maybe come to the business organisations first. And it's about the timing of developing skills within the supply chain to meet what we know in the future will be needs. But how do you do that in a way that means that you're developing new skills now, even though they're not being deployed now, but they'll be needed to be deployed in the future? Because we've got this conundrum that if we don't do that now, if we wait until 5 years, then, you know, the skills won't be there, and then the supply chain means that it'll be, you know, other countries and other manufacturers that will be benefiting from the domestic capability or potential we have here. So can maybe come to you first, Hisashi, and then to Liz. If you can maybe give me a perspective of how do we bridge that to make sure that we're building that skills base? What does it mean for SMEs?
Yeah,
how do we bridge that gap?
That's a difficult or interesting question. I think the what's happening within the SME communities is that the when they find it difficult to rely on the graduates from either from schools or colleges or universities to employ because they might not have the right set skills, they tend to start their own skills academy, for example, and then, you know, they just take the training in-house and then provide necessary skills and training for those who come to their skills academy, and then they employ people later on rather than straight from colleges and universities or schools. So what's happening is I think the businesses find it difficult to work with the local colleges and schools, and so that the graduates, the people coming through, the young people coming through the education system have the necessary skill set. So they tend to take things in hand and in-house, and then they do just training and provision of skills training themselves. So the I think it's because how the college system or school system is made up, I think it's at the moment it's quite difficult for SMEs to find the right skill set from those who graduate from the education system. I think that really means the you know, close collaboration between small businesses and colleges might have to be improved future. Therefore, if we really want to find a solution to the skill gap situation at the moment.
But the skill gap's going to be for 5 years' time, not now. Mm. So graduates coming out now will need jobs. They can't just hang around for 5 years.
I think do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I could come and give you a really good example of how this could work. So the Infrastructure Investment Programme Board for Edinburgh is set up to deliver a green investment plan for the city. So it involves the Scottish Power, Scottish Gas, Scottish Water, the NHS, the universities. And by developing a green investment plan, we're looking at the key infrastructure projects that are going to happen anyway. So whether it's building substations to increase demand, whether it's building district heating systems for the Royal Infirmary, we will develop a plan and we will know the big projects that will happen over the next 10, 15, 20 years. When you've got that line of sight of those projects, you then know the workforce that's needed to deliver those projects, and you can see the skills that are required of those workforces. So I think the more that we can start looking at green investment plans across Scotland, not just Edinburgh, it's just a good model. We need to see that line of sight, because if you invest in skills too soon and then they can't get the jobs, then they're obviously going to get jobs elsewhere and that upskilling and retraining will be wasted. So the timing is really, really important, as you say. So we need to sort of... And Skills Development Scotland are really interested in this because they're not seeing this anywhere else. And very excited of what's that line of sight, so that we can start planning when it's going to happen, what skills do we need, and then when do we engage with the colleges to make sure that we can provide those skills.
And we've obviously had a number of examples from Edinburgh and Leith, etc. We're focusing on Grangemouth.
I understand.
So that. Do you think that kind of model that you've just talked about exists or is in development in Grangemouth, or is that something that really needs to be pushed?
I can talk about that. It definitely already exists, as Forth Ports. We already partner with Forth Valley College, for example, to ensure that we've got a pipeline of skills. We have an established apprentice programme and an adult apprentice programme and a really good graduate programme. And we also look internally at our own employees in terms of upskilling, reskilling and emerging technologies, particularly in digitalisation and automation. So they're already on our existing plans and we're already working with those local partners in that area. In terms of obviously future, as part of the fourth Green fourth bid process, there's also a 2.1 million investment fund to again enhance those skills around those same kind of principles, but looking at again upskilling, reskilling, emerging technologies with those partners, particularly in the Grangemouth area and beyond. But definitely Grangemouth will benefit from that as it does now. We also partner with local SMEs in the Grangemouth area to help them with any skills that they currently need. We have a skills centre on Grangemouth in our port of Grangemouth, and they deliver training externally and help those SMEs to upskill where they're maybe lacking at the moment. And we do that in partnership again with Forth Valley College or just directly with them to support the local community and those SMEs develop.
So you've all spoken about schools and colleges, and which is obviously young people, but obviously we've got a lot of existing workforce in the area, and you talked about your employees sometimes having 15 years plus experience. So what engagement have you had today, or will you have, with the existing workforce in order to identify the skills they have that can be then adapted, or reskilling, etc., and also work with the trade unions? Is that a joint thing in terms of developing the kind of that sightline for them as individuals?
Yeah, we do have in Forth Ports an effective employee voice. So our apprenticeships aren't just focused at young people. We do a lot of adult apprenticeships, and even in our port operations, as part of their development, they go through a modern apprenticeship programme, again updating their kind of skills and giving them an increase in terms of accessibility to skills and development. We don't just focus on the young people, it is about being able to develop our existing workforce, and that's why we do the SME engagement as well. So we are accredited and we can provide our own apprenticeships, and we also have RTITB training in terms of cranes and other equipment that we can deliver internally. So it isn't just primarily focused at young people, it is our existing workforce as well, to make sure that they continually develop. And as well, as I've said, supporting the SMEs at all levels in their workforce, not just young people.
So we talked earlier on about the corporates being able to help develop the SME base in terms of business opportunities, but also in training. Do you think that will be a shared responsibility to get corporates will, like obviously the ones you yourself and others you work with, will do that.
Yep. There's also plans, Fiona, as part of the working groups or the subcommittees of the governance around the fourth Green Freeport. There'll be a skills one, and we plan to have trade union representation on that skills group. So a combination of education providers, private sector and the trade unions looking at what the need is for the wider skills development as the benefits of the Freeport come through. So that will be an individual working group that will work on that, and that will feed up through into the governance body to make sure that we're delivering on that for today and for the future.
And can I ask something completely different, if that's OK? Obviously, you've talked about Acorn and the importance of that, and actually the Net Zero Committee in this Parliament did an inquiry last year, and was very supportive of it on a cross-party basis. The development of hydrogen would be quite interesting. We know that, obviously, we don't necessarily see it within the heat network, and the UK's decision on hydrogen isn't due to be made, I think, till 2026. But do you see as part of that community just transition an opportunity to have the area, the people and the housing in Grangemouth potentially using hydrogen as a heat source as part of that just transition? As what does the community get from this? Is that in scope, do you think?
I don't know the detailed answer to that, Fiona, other than I certainly know that of conversations that we've had over many years. So if I was personally involved in what was the potential development of a biomass power plant at Grangemouth a number of years ago, and as part of that we openly talked about heat networks and local heat distribution. So I see no reason why, and the bigger concept of just transition, and when you look at the draft energy policy and the just transition plan that's been published by the Scottish Government, it very openly talks about how we see things like fuel and energy security, how we see fuel pricing being dealt with, how we deal with enabling local communities across the whole of Scotland to switch away from the reliance on fossil fuel type development. So I think all of that should be in the mix as we see some of these emerging technologies come through, and as we develop either more onshore wind in terms of repowering or installing more, and as we see offshore wind develop, I think that's an important part of the strategy going forward as to what does that mean for us in terms of the wider communities in which we stay. Yeah.
Thank you. So that was a bit of diversion, but I thought I'd ask. Is there anything else on skills that you, any of you want to let us know about, or what you would ask for or need? This is your chance to...
Ask another question on skills. It probably does follow on from that, because we have heard, you know, from Michelle, I've set out Forth Port's activities and the work with the college and the support that's there. But I suppose from Liz and... sorry, my mind's gone blank. It's okay. Hisashi, I was just thinking of the pronunciation. I was just trying to get it right, Hisashi. Apologies. Whether, because Liz, you've set out the plans in Edinburgh, taking, you know, a strategic, a longer term view and planning. Do you feel that for your sectors and your, the businesses you represent, that that is happening, that you have access to the skills, that you're confident that you can, that your businesses can get access to what is needed? And whether this is broader than just the energy sector, and, you know, so while that is key to the changes that need to happen in Grangemouth, a just transition. Because we earlier talked about the interpretation of a just transition, and I think Maggie's tried to pull out that it's about more than just the energy sector, and the government are part of the Wellbeing Economy Alliance as well. There's kind of bigger issues here about the whole region and what the change, the energy changes will have a bigger impact than just what happens in terms of energy. So that's quite a broad question. But I suppose if we come to Liz, first of all, because you've described in Edinburgh a kind of strategic view, do you think a strategic approach has been taken in Grangemouth, setting aside the work that Forth Ports is doing?
I think what would, if you go back to your sort of first part of your question, what could help? Quite a number of years ago, there used to be, I think it was called ILAs, Independent Learning. Trying to think what the
accounts.
Yes. Yeah, anyway, and individuals were given, I think it was £500 or something like that, that they could spend on their own development and training. And I think when that was taken away, we ran a lot of training programs for SMEs. And when that was taken away, we just saw an absolute drop in businesses that were investing in their people. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, if I was to make an ask, knowing that there's kind of no pots of money in, hidden away anywhere, it would be to think about reinstating some form of independent learning allowance so that people could take ownership of their own training as well.
Mm-hmm. And then Hisashi, you had said at the beginning that in terms of the Future Industry, Grangemouth Future Industry Board, that there's not a small business representative on that board, and many of your small businesses, some of them will be part of the supply chain, other ones are just businesses that are based in Grangemouth but will still be impacted. In terms of skills and that agenda, do you feel there's a recognition of the role that your members play and the support that they need?
I think we have to see how the Future Industry Board's engagement plan works, and at the moment the small businesses are aware of the importance of reducing carbon emission, and they're doing what they can. But I don't think there's significant sort of the sense of ownership from them, if that makes sense. You know, they are aware, but it's not like, you know, they have the, for example, a concrete plan to achieve net zero and by 2045, because they don't know where to start and they don't know how far they should go. So what we'd like to see is the engagement exercise to understand the need of the, you know, those in the petrochemical sector and also others, as you mentioned, because Grangemouth has hundreds of businesses, I think, there. And there's from all the sectors. And then we need to understand what they know at the moment and what they need to achieve net zero from the area's perspective. And as I said earlier, I think it's important to see them as part of a solution rather than leave them behind as a problem.
Okay, thank you.
So if I could just add one small point to that, you know, we talk about this being a just transition. I think it's worth mentioning something like only 25% of these jobs are filled by women at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I think it's something that we need to address, that how do we encourage more women into this sector as well? Because they've got a lot to contribute.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah, because we did have the publication of Anna Stewart report in recent days. The committee does take an interest in this area. So thank you for that contribution. Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much. I mean, it's been fascinating so far, and the convener has helpfully mopped up some of my questions. But I'll go back. If I can just go back on this Future Industry Board, because it's a little bit concerning, Hisashi, that there's no SME involvement in that at the moment. Has there been any dialogue at all with them?
No. As I mentioned, I think they seem to have the wider engagement plan starting this year. So if they approach us, we are more than welcome to work with them and then help working with our members and wider small business community.
Could you approach them?
I could, yes. They're probably through some efforts to contact or cancel, yes.
It might be useful, but perhaps they're watching this session and they'll pick up on this and they might reach out.
I'm sure the council has they do engage with local small SME communities, so they did the work through that channel, but not with us at the moment.
Okay, so I want to ask about the engagement with colleges, because that's been mentioned a few times, and Forth Valley College is obviously the local one. So I guess it might be for you, Michelle, actually, because you seem to know all about that. When you're speaking to a college like Forth Valley, are you talking about the jobs of the future? Is there sort of future planning involved, or are you just designing courses for things that you need now? Are you looking ahead?
We're absolutely looking ahead, and in terms of some of the good work we've been doing with Forth Valley, there's a lot of carbon literacy in there as well for schools and higher education and our workforce. So Forth Valley were instrumental in developing Fuel Change Challenge, and we use that both in, it goes into schools, it goes into higher education, and we use it with our apprentices, both young apprentices and adult apprentices, in their learning and development of that. So yes, we're definitely talking about that. We're also working with Forth Valley and other partners, Stirling University, Edinburgh College, particularly depending on what the discipline is. and Skills Development Scotland on meta skills of the future, and that now, you know, forms very much part of our apprenticeship and existing employee training as well, to be honest.
Okay.
Can I add to that as well, Graham?
Yeah. I think having gone through the experience of a bid down south and a bid in Scotland, I would say I was hugely encouraged by the collaboration that was there across Fife, Edinburgh, Falkirk College and the universities, be it Strathclyde or Edinburgh, and those conversations that we had as part of the bid process. Now, we're at the start now of the business plan and the implementation of that, but there was a very, very strong collaboration and desire to work collaboratively across FE and HE establishments to make sure that we deliver those skills for the future. Okay. And one of the learnings that we had from down south and we will take to Scotland as well is to actually say what are those industries of the future and to start to map out what are the qualifications that are required as a result of that. So is it a graduate or is it a modern apprenticeship type programme? What kind of level of SQA qualification will require? And those will range quite widely across the different sectors that we're talking about, but that mapping exercise will be done to then work in collaboration with the HE and the FE organisations to say, how are we going to deliver this training for the future going forward?
That's very encouraging, and I think it partly addresses Colin Beattie's concerns earlier about where do we find the workers from, where we can actually, in part, develop our own. And that's what that's about. And Michelle, you mentioned earlier that you're working with SMEs on skills. How many companies are you working with? And is it possible for us to, as a committee, to sort of get a sort of flavour of the type of businesses that you're working with?
Yeah, I absolutely can. I can provide that later. We have open days with SMEs into Grangemouth, into the Skills and Business Centre to be able to, again, engage with them and also be able to share information on what we can provide and help them with. So we've done that twice last year and we intend to do that again this year to kind of build on that. But certainly we can provide that information on who we've engaged with and what skills we're talking about.
That would be great. I'm just going to dot about a bit because I'm the last one up. Now, Stuart, you can't speak for INEOS, and it's a shame that we haven't spoken to INEOS in this session. I think we may get to meet them, but they're clearly a key part of this. I mean, you mentioned, Stuart, things like sustainable aviation fuel and biofuels, and they're really important. You know, if we can be producing sustainable aviation fuel at Grangemouth, that could be really important to the Scottish economy. I know you're not INEOS, but I wonder if you could say.
I'm not INEOS, but what I can say is I can say as part of the bid, then we openly talked in the bid process about how, for example, you get alignment with the Falkirk Growth Deal. And you get the aspirations that were there with the Green Freeport bid that went in. And we talked in the bid about how you use the skills, the expertise, the infrastructure, for example, that exists in that petrochemicals complex at the moment. And we got into the area of master planning, for example, so back to the comment earlier on how you're creating jobs. So we earmarked an area of land that INEOS over the past few years have taken redundant plant and equipment out, and it's now brownfield redundant site. And we identified this potential there for biofuel technology. Right. So if I talk about our business, that part of our journey to carbon neutral is about how we shift to the greater use of, for example, HVO rather than full-blown diesel. But if everybody's doing that, then we all have to make sure that we've got this supply chain and a sustainable and credible supply chain of an alternative fuel like HVO. So that biofuels complex was there. The hydrogen hub concept was there as well in terms of an area of land that would be used to do that, as well as an area that was set aside for innovation. So I totally agree, Graham. I think if I look at the petrochemicals complex and the skills, the knowledge, the expertise that exists in that sector in Scotland, in central Scotland and in Grangemouth at the moment, then I know that they have, and the Green Freeport bid has aspirations to use that to be moving into those alternative fuel sources. That is Scotland's only refinery. It is supplying all of Scotland's fuel, aviation fuel, as well as areas of, like, for example, Ireland and the north of England. So that is hugely important as we find the very smart, innovative engineers who will come up with the fuels of the future then how do we use that skill set and infrastructure that exists there today to create that capability for tomorrow?
Completely yeah. agree. And that, of course, you know, if we manage to produce more biofuels and that helps the freight sector, it helps small businesses that can run vehicles on them, for example. Everything helps. I've been trying to get a picture while listening to this session of how are things going to look in the town of Grangemouth and in the port in 5, 10, 15 years, you know, in terms of, you know, how are things going to improve? And if we can look at the town of Grangemouth first, because Fiona's question led to you, Stuart, I think, mention district. There was a talk of a district heating scheme in Grangemouth. I think that idea came from the council, but it never progressed. For me, if we were able to find the investment, the money that could, you know, roll that sort of scheme out, that's a huge bonus for a place like Grangemouth. So have there been any further discussions on that?
Not at that level of detail at this point in time. I think the concept of the success of the fourth Green Freeport, though, however, in terms of the additional non-domestic rates revenue that gets generated from that, of which the UK and the Scottish governments have agreed gets retained 100% locally, then those discussions that we had as part of the bid and subsequent to the bid with the local authorities is that they will be wanting to engage fully with their members to say, how are we going to take the uplift in receipts that we've got from this and make a difference locally? So that concept of the 20-minute community, or how do you actually develop and make Grangemouth feel differently than what it is at the moment? So, I mean, if I reflect back in my time in Forth Ports, the port of Grangemouth is a very different place than what it was 5-10 years ago. We continue to be Scotland's largest container terminal, but we've also developed 500,000 square feet of warehousing. We've got Scotland's only maximum length rail freight siding inside the port. If you look at the work that's been done on the M9 and some of the signalisation and roundabouts and things, it has improved the flow of traffic around the town, the way that we've worked with the council and the local community to make sure that traffic flows in the right way to make a difference to the town residents, I think are all important. So I think the aspiration that's there in terms of the Green Freeport is that we will see this just transition and retention of economic benefit in the Grangemouth area that we can hopefully aspire to and succeed in making sure that we see SMEs develop and grow, so we'll retain much more of that economic activity in the town, and we can address some pretty dire deprivation and unemployment statistics that exist in that town actually by working with schools, with working with the local colleges to teach to provide the information to the local community that needs to understand about the opportunities that should exist on their doorstep to keep that economic activity there. And you get a feel for the town. I mean, some of the work that's been done recently in things like the Zetland Park, where there's been a lot of investment in terms of doing that, there's open discussion about what happens with the town centre. And me personally, if I look back to things that have happened over the years, of things like the Kelpies and when that was created, and the connection a bit more strongly again between Falkirk and Grangemouth and the way that the Forth and Clyde Canal has changed, there's a very different feel around that local area than what there was 10, 15 years ago. And I would like to see that continue to happen and for the town to benefit out of the Freeport economic activity that happens.
Yeah, Liz.
I just wanted to kind of make a point. Going back to your early point about how communities can benefit from potentially district heating systems and things like that. I'm not an expert on it, but LHEs are really kind of being developed now. So LHEs are the local heat and energy efficiency strategies that all local authorities will be developing. I think it's a 6-point plan to get to this strategy. And that really looks about utilising energy efficiency in district heating systems and sort of developments having to be part and utilising this strategy. So I think that will help that process as well.
Yeah, no, it would help some of your members as well because they get to work out of it.
Yeah,
which is a good thing. Just one final point, and it's about engagement with the community. We put out a call for views. We didn't have a huge response, but of those that responded from the local area, the clear message coming across was that they weren't hearing very much about what was planned for Grangemouth, or indeed what's going on. It seems to be there's a bit of a disconnect between, well, you, Forthport, and people who live in the town. So I think, if I can reflect on that, it's good that you contact local elected members and community councils, but I think you do need to go beyond that.
We're actually facilitating port tours on Grangemouth in the summer, so we've already got that planned. We're coming up to a bit of an anniversary in Grangemouth, so we're inviting the local community into those port tours so that we can provide them with updates on what's happening in Grangemouth and particularly in Forthport, and to raise further awareness about some of the work that we've done about just what is on your doorstep and the prospects that it can bring. So we recognise that, and that's a key focus for us this year. Those dates are already planned. I can provide them.
So how's that being advertised?
We literally just signed it off last week. I promise you, we had a meeting in Leith, so we're working on it, and we'll certainly get that out there. But we will use our kind of media channels, and we'll certainly connect in with our partners to do that as well.
Yeah, we're fully engaging with the primary schools around the 150th anniversary of the town of Grangemouth, and where it came from and where it is now, and that culminates in an event at the library. Celebrating 150, we've got an ex-employee who's written a poem about the town, and then on the back of that we're doing the tours round about the port. Yes, the port used to be completely open, and it was the linkage between the old and the new town, but unfortunately in the back of 9/11 and some security arrangements that had to come in, then that's not the case. So we are going to invite the public in to see actually what happens in the port estate.
Okay.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of this evidence session. I would like to thank the panel members for their contribution this morning. You've helped set the scene for the inquiry we're about to undertake and raise some key issues we'll explore with other witnesses in the coming weeks. I'll now move into private session.